And maybe, Nicole, can you comment on other chemoimmunotherapy regimens? So we touched on it, spent a lot of time on FCR. What about BR or chlorambucil or obinutuzumab?
Yeah, I mean, obviously those are, the efficacy I don't think is certainly not as good as with FCR, but as we spoke of earlier, clearly that those regimens are less myelosuppressive and easier for some of our patients who have other comorbidities to handle more aggressive chemoimmunotherapy approaches. So bendamustine and rituximab sort of became the most popular regimen over the past couple of years before the TKIs became available versus FCR for the physicians who weren't comfortable with the enhanced cytopenias and myelosuppression in FCR. Certainly, I think that's certainly, you certainly can use that as an alternative treatment option. Now, whether or not we're going to pursue looking at similar approaches with BR and TKIs, probably not. I mean, we've seen a lot of data in the relapse refractory setting where when bendamustine rituximab and chemoimmunotherapy regimens were so widely used in the relapse refractory setting, we just started adding ibrutinib to or idelalisib or other TKIs in the relapse refractory setting because many patients were getting BR in relapse. I don't think you see a lot of use of that type of combination anymore in the relapse refractory despite the Helios study and so on and so forth. Whether or not that people are going to move that up front, I'm not so sure. I mean, I think that I think it's important for the trials that we're all involved with to do similar to what you're doing or other groups are looking at how to truncate if we're going to use some chemoimmunotherapy because we're looking at MRD and how durable responses will last and then whether or not you can reinitiate a TKI or a BCL2 inhibitor upon relapse of the MRD and will that alter, you know, their disease or the biology. I think those are important strategies, ultimately looking at whether or not you can cure somebody. I think those are important alternative strategies. Right now, I don't think that's practical to do in mainstream until we have that data. But certainly, as Steve said, using, you know, obinutuzumab and chlorambucil are alternative strategies in an older, frailer patient that you don't think can take ibrutinib or a TKI for some reason, I think is okay. But I think we're going to see movement away from some of the chemoimmunotherapy approaches.
I think one important question in this era of novel therapy is there still some role for immunochemotherapy for patients who are not 17p deletion? So when you're discussing, I always discuss the options with the patient, so either use ibrutinib-based therapy or immunochemotherapy. You never know, some patients may be actually having strong preference for the time-limited therapy. Mm-hmm. So the appeal of immunochemotherapy is that it's time-limited versus a indefinite therapy with the TKIs.
Yeah, so if we can enhance that by doing a truncated version, such as what was presented, that would be great, you know.
And
so,
I think that may be sufficient for the mutated IGHV patients like the ones in your study.
Yep.
But in our study, we had unmutated IGHV patients who clearly benefited from the additional three cycles of FCR.
Absolutely.
We had far.
And that might be needed.
Yeah, and it might be needed for that group. But I think ultimately it'd be great if we had a chemotherapy-free approach for the unmutated patients that also was time-limited. And there's a lot of exciting data I'm sure we'll get to that looks at that type of approach as well.
So maybe, Steve, you can comment on, is there a role, first comment on, is there a role for CD20 monotherapy in CLL and what that might be briefly, and then we'll move into ibrutinib and maybe you can tell us what, in the frontline setting, how well does it work, who are the patients at high risk, and what are some of the challenges we have with ibrutinib in the frontline?
Sure. Well, I think, as we all know, there used to be probably still is, quite a lot of use of single-agent rituximab in elderly patients because, you know, it's not chemotherapy and it's well-tolerated and it shrinks your lymph nodes and your lymphocyte count goes down. So a typical elderly patient perhaps who's not, has comorbidities, very, very widely used in the U.S. And I think ibrutinib has changed that dynamic and will continue to change it. We perhaps have a better anti-CD20 antibody, obinutuzumab, but I don't think, you know, it's going to shift from Rituxan to that as monotherapy. I think it'll go more towards the oral agents. But as I mentioned, you know, you occasionally have a patient where giving obinutuzumab, that's what I would use for a typical six-month course, achieves the goal in that patient. Now, with ibrutinib, as a single agent for upfront therapy. We have, the longest data we have, of course, is from our very first CLL trial after the first in-man studies were done. And we have long-term follow-up presented at this meeting and other recent meetings. There were 31 patients in that cohort. And those, in contrast to virtually any other upfront CLL study that you'll see, including the combination regimens, that was the average CLL patient. You had to be over 65. It was this typical criteria for needing treatment. And I think the median age was in the early, mid-70s. So that's what you see in practice. So 31 patients, one patient progressed at 8 months. They had some unusual features even at diagnosis. One patient progressed, I think, somewhere like four and a half years out. Nobody else has progressed. I have several patients on the drug for more than 7 years. So it speaks to its efficacy, and it speaks to its tolerability in the long term. So that's intriguing. And then, of course, we had the Resonate 2 trial, which was really sort of the registration trial, and that was randomized to chlorambucil. Of course, we don't care about that, but that's how you get it approved at the time. So what's more interesting from that trial, of course, is how will patients who receive ibrutinib as their initial therapy do long term? And again, limited to age over 65. And so far, what's been reported, and there's an update here as well, is I believe there's been 4 patients who have progressed. There have been other patients who've come off, of course, for other reasons, but, you know, 4 progressions. So, again, very intriguing to me. You know, I think we're changing the natural history of the disease. I think we're going to see less 17p in relapse because we're not using chemoimmunotherapy. And for an average CLL patient, you know, nothing wrong with managing their disease for the rest of their natural lives, even if you don't eliminate it. I mean, after all, that's what we mostly do with TKIs and CML. So it's I think that to me is really, really interesting data to follow as it goes out longer.